Yeah, I believe my screen is visible, right?
Sir.
Yeah, perfect. So I'll start. Today's topic is how to trade small caps and mid caps using technical analysis. Now, before I get into that, I will be very clear a standard disclosure. I'm a SEBI registered investment advisor. And all the stocks covered in the session, I don't know where is the voice coming from. I think there is some.
Sir, I'll mute everybody. Just a second, I'll mute everybody. We'll yes, sir, we mute. See if the voice.
Yeah, now there is no disturbance. I think once you've also muted yourself, it should be fine. All right. So, a standard disclosure, I'm a registered investment advisor. So, all the stocks covered in the presentation are not investment ideas. Please do your own research, consult your investment advisor. And all the stocks we've taken as examples are past examples. So we've not taken any, say, recommendations per se. So that is where I make myself clear in terms of SEBI compliances. And say in this topic, we are looking towards small caps and mid caps specifically. So a lot of setups which we look out for is fully focused. So it's a very clear-cut focused topic. How to trade small caps and mid caps using technical analysis. A brief introduction about myself. I'll not be very brief because it will be very interesting because I've had an interesting say journey in the markets over the last many years. So I'm an IT engineer by qualification. I got into the markets in May 2005, 2004. And just so how did I get into the markets as a curious decision? That is where it is interesting. So I got into touch with my mama, Mr. N.S. Vidya, who's my mentor. And he got into the markets full time around that time. And he and his friends were discussing elections mein koi bhi jeete, BJP or Congress, market girega. So they had this view that the markets will fall irrespective of election results. And that is where the first lower circuit, which happened, was on 17 May 2004. And that was just maybe what a week of my into the markets. And this is what I saw. And maybe that is one reason I've been more cautious or say at times. And then we started shorting the markets. But the whole point is that is where the curiosity came in. And that is where I got into the markets. The reason I talk about this is because there's a lot of similarities. So in 2004, we started shorting the markets when the bounce back happened. And then we dipped a bit. And the trades were working superbly fine. And when the trend changed in 2004 end to 2005, that gave us a big hit. And that is where we realized that we should not always be waiting for a double dip. The double dip is not the best trade. The best trade on the short side is on the way down itself. And so since then, the learning period started in 2006. That is where we started recovering and thinking, and the whole scenario changed because we spent a lot of time learning what not to do. So read about various topics in technical analysis, anything which was available online. And being online, finding stuff online between 2004 to 6 was difficult because we had a dial-up connection, MTNL, etc. in those days. So I remember downloading Elliott Wave books, GAN analysis books, scanned books in those times from free websites, etc. to learn. And so over the next few years, we realized what not to do and how to keep it simple. And then I passed out of engineering. I used to write a blog. Before the blog, I used to write on Orkut. So, and that was very interesting because in those times, Orkut communities had 1 lakh participants on a single group. I don't know how many people out here are part of those times. And post that, I started a, so somebody kicked me out of the Google Orkut group. So one of the moderators around that said, you should start your own blog on Blogspot. So I started on Blogspot, then it shifted to WordPress when the time came. And over the years, then we used bulk SMS, then we used various utilities and social media. I had a lot of learning from my lot of social media part. I have a full, say, I would go longer on that. But the point is, a lot of my learning in terms of investing and trading has kept on coming from meeting people, discussing with people. So in 2009, I became very active on one of the WhatsApp Google groups. Now it is all about WhatsApp groups. And that is where over the last 11 years, I've met a lot of investors. Many of them are now very well known. And that is where the learning came from and how a fundamental research guy also works. So that has been my journey. So I've been on Twitter, etc., on various social media over the last 15 years. So basically, it ends up looking like that I just blog, tweet, and chat. That seems to be my job. And that is what I do for most of the time, apart from the trades I take. So I quit in the quit my IT job in 6 months. So I've been full-time from January 2007, in a role of trader, advisor, educator. And I've been writing on technical analysis and topics on nureshtech.co.in ever since 2004-05. And there would be maybe 3,000 different posts which I've written on it. So you can go through the website. You'll see a lot of articles which are older. And say, in hindsight, maybe I should have become a tech blogger. Then I would have been more, say, a very different scale in terms of number of, say, viewers and various other things. But one has to look at what you like the most. So although my name on the website is nureshtech.co.in, and for a long period of time, I would keep getting emails from any tech announcements which were to happen. So that's a brief about me. I've conducted training sessions on technical analysis across India. So that's a brief about me. I would like to go about what I've learned over the years, but that will maybe keep it for another session. And credit where due. So Harsh Doshi is my teammate. He works with me full time and he does a lot of work the same way I look at charts together. He loves to work on data and crunching. He keeps using all the new tools which come up. He does a lot of the work, so a lot of the presentation work. So a lot of work gets done by her. So let us give him the credit. And he puts out some interesting YouTube videos, etc. And for anything. So he's like the go-to guy in terms of data for me. So all the Excel sheet work to everything we do. So that's Harsh. So that's about us. So we've been looking at technicals and fundamentals for a long period of time. We are still learning. We've had our good times, bad times, terrible times. So what is today's agenda? So let us focus on, say, what are we going to talk today? So there are four topics mainly which we'll talk about. So we are talking about small caps and mid caps. So the first part is when to trade small caps and mid caps. This is where most of the mistakes happen because, say, being a full-time investor or even a trader, or most of us are generally small caps, mid caps, and we try to trade through all cycles. And that is where most mistakes happen. So when to cut down on trading and investing in small caps and mid caps. So that is the first part. Second part is what chart patterns, what strength, what price action, what to look out for in small caps. How does it differ from something which happens in a large cap? Then third, why do we look at volumes and delivery volumes very importantly in terms of small caps, and why are they important? And last part is, this is more like a ride the trend in risk management. This is not a very long topic, but it's a very small topic in terms of what sort of moves happen in small caps when they go right. So this is the brief agenda. We'll try to cover most of the topics with examples. So it will be more example oriented. But before we start that, we should start off with a nice joke, because what are we sitting at is, I'm doing a webinar on a Sunday afternoon, and say, I think there are more webinars happening today. So this joke was for pre-COVID times. There were more advisors, more trainers, more technical analysts than maybe actual investors. So that is the joke we make. And I'm an investment advisor also myself. But today it seems there are more people who do webinars than people who attend webinars, because it seems that the audience is similar. So this is the joke. I followed your investment advice and lost all my savings in the market. Did I mention that past performance is not an indication of future returns? Then how does advice actually work? It only works for the people that give it. Then lessons in investing: you should buy a stock whenever the chart looks like a squirrel sitting on a clown's shoulder. That's called technical analysis. I'm not going to do that. Good, because it doesn't work if everyone does it. So just to start off on a quick joke. So what happens is people think it is just too easy. And then there comes terrible, tough markets. And that is where suddenly we start doubting everything we know about markets. So let's get started. And say, just a specific request, I would suggest everyone to keep looking at the charts, because I'll be discussing some parts, but you'll have to keep looking at the presentation, because there's a lot of data which is there on the presentation. So maybe if you can zoom up the screen or however you want to, so there will be a lot of data on the screen. So just stay focused on it. So when to trade small caps and mid caps? So one of the biggest mistakes we make is we all have done is continue trading through small caps and mid caps heavily across market cycles. And I being the worst culprit of it all, because I've been always a small cap investor. And generally, anyone who's a small cap investor and trader, it's very difficult to take a seat back and avoid trading. So this is over the years, this is a framework which I've decided. So these are the six checklist points where a lot of them should be ticking for us to participate into small caps and mid caps as a short term trade, as a medium trade, or as even a little longer term trade. So these are the times where you want to trade small caps. But here a lot more focus is on a shorter term view, where we are talking about 3 months to 12 months. We are not talking about a 5 year view in small caps. We are talking about a good 3 months, 6 months, 2 months, maximum of 2-3 years period, which is like the golden period for small caps generally in a cycle. So how do you be part of those cycle and when not to be a part of it? So the fact is, when the trend is superb, you just can touch anything and it will work. So let us understand how it will be. So what are the things which we want to look out for? So the first criteria is Nifty is in a higher top, higher bottom formation. That is one. Second, the small cap and the mid cap indices are also in a higher top, higher bottom formation, which is a proper trending bull market. There is no divergence in BSE small cap to Nifty. When we say divergence, what it implies is, so the Nifty is up 10%, the BSE small cap index is up 40%. That's a divergence. Nifty is up 10%, BSE is down 15-20%. That's not a divergence which you're scary about. The scary period is where your BSE small cap tends to beat the Nifty by a factor of 3. So we'll go deeper into this part also. Then fourth is a long-term major breakout in major indices. Now, many a times this breakout could only be in the Nifty, the small cap and the mid cap would yet be breaking out. But that would be the best time. Then fifth is a positive divergence followed by a breakout. So for example, small caps go through a very long period of say consolidation and correction, where the market fall is between 30 to 70%. After that, when there's a positive divergence, you don't buy on a divergence, you wait for the prices to break out after that. So that tells you a bottom has been made. So that is the time you want to start participating. You don't want to buy in the bottom technically. Then the sixth part is relative strength in small caps and mid cap indices compared to the Nifty. What I mean to say is the Nifty is struggling down, the small cap, mid cap indices are flat. Now this may be a time to trade small caps and mid caps, but it may not be a time to say look at all the small caps and mid caps. So this may be a time to where you become very, very focused in terms of the stock selection. So these are the six checklists. So consider a lot of them should be ticking right. So if a lot of them are ticking right, that is the time to trade small caps. Why do we say this? Is if your timing is right, you just need not be betting on the right stock. So let us look at, so what we've done here is we've taken two charts. The one on the top is BSE small cap. The one on the bottom is Nifty 50. So this is the chart, a daily chart for the last from 2008-9 till 2020. That's like 10 to 12 years of data crunched onto this. Then what are we trying to look out for is Nifty is in a higher top, higher bottom formation, small cap indices in, and relative strength. So these are three ticks we'll try to first look out for. So this is the period where you want to participate the max, which is where the bottom has been made in 2008. The trend has changed. We've started making higher tops, higher bottoms here. And this is that one and a half year period where Nifty is in higher tops and higher bottoms, and the small cap continues into higher tops and higher bottoms. Now, this is the period where you will make good money even if you bet on the wrong stocks in a later period. So this is a time even a HCC went up 5x between this time to this time. It would be up 10x from the bottoms. Even a Unitech went up. A lot of companies which are totally junk today actually went up between 3x to 10x in the recovery of 2009 to 10. It's only in hindsight later we realize everything has gone bad. So this is what happens. So in this cycle, you'll make money irrespective of what you buy. So as in, your chances of making money are way higher. The second part is the next superb period similarly is when we started. So this is where we start in a downtrend where there is the Nifty is struggling. The mid cap and small cap indices are also struggling. This is where a new breakout happens in between March to April 2014. So that's an all time high. That's an all-time high on the Nifty. Now that's a six-year high. So you are at 6,300 in Nifty in 2007-8. You were at 6,300 in 2010. You were at 6,300 in 2013. Finally, in 2014, you crossed that 6,300, 6,400 mark. And the BSE Small Cap Index has not broken out. So this is where it has only gone into a higher top, higher bottom formation, but it's not a long-term breakout. Most of the times, long-term breakout in the index, the Nifty, may not coincide with a long-term breakout on the Small Cap Index. So this is the time you want to start participating, and clearly you might start in March 2014 or you start after June 2014. We are in a higher top, higher bottom formation. So this is that lovely period of again, say between 3 to 12 months where it was a clean move. Post that, you got into a period of relative strength in the small cap. So the Nifty is in a downward channel. Your mid cap and the small cap indices are in a sideways channel. So this is where you go to the next part of selecting stocks, which we'll try to look ahead, is in such sideways period, you don't want to focus on all the stocks. You want to focus on leaders, stocks which are making new all-time highs. Relative strength is great. What I mean by relative strength is, say the Nifty has topped out at 9,000 Nifty in March 2015. Stocks which have crossed the March 2015 high. Second way to look at it is you look at ratio charts to say, okay, the stock by BSE small cap, the stock by Nifty. When you do that ratio chart, the ratio charts are making new highs. So in this period, you want to buy leadership stocks, which are, so you're not buying all the small caps, you're only buying leadership stocks. So for example, this was this brilliant period where textiles went up between 100 to 400% in 2015 to 2016, where the Nifty fell down by 20%. Same way, there were some chemical names which did similar. There were some sugar names which did something similar. And by end of it, there were metals, papers, and a lot of leadership. But a lot of leadership was in textiles and chemicals. So you want to participate in a relative strength of small caps and mid cap indices. Participate on the stocks which are showing relative strength. So that's the next, say, a thumb rule. Then we again go into an all-time high out here, as in not an all-time high, but a higher top, higher bottom formation here. But this becomes a new 52-week high for the small cap. So this is the period of 2016 where we start recovering from the lows in February 2016. Again, higher top and higher bottom formation. Then when the higher top bottom formation goes off, that is the time you want to reduce. The next superb period was after demonetization. So the demonetization bottom happens. We make a classical double bottom formation. Somewhere out here in this period, you realize maybe at 8,000 Nifty, at 9,000 Nifty, but at 9,000 Nifty, you clearly realize because it's also an all-time high. So that is the time between 8,000 to 9,000 Nifty, where it's also a 52-week high for the small cap. That becomes the best period. Now, in hindsight, demonetization was supposed to be real bad for a lot of stocks and the economy. Trump election back in those days was supposed to be negative. But what did the market do in the next 1 year? It was the most cleanest year in terms of without a much of a correction across the world. I am seeing a clean year in terms of correction. So even the best bull market phases of 2003 to 2007 did not have a period of 1 year with a less than 8 to 10%, 6 to 10% drawdown on the benchmark indices across the world. So the year which people expected things to go bad ended up becoming a period where things went really well for a lot of stocks. So, for example, in this particular year, in 2017, So demonetization was supposed to be a common sense negative for real estate stock. The real estate index went up by more than 150% in that particular year itself. So that's why many a times market tends to surprise in various directions which we don't think of. And that is why price action is very, very important, because a lot of our biases are for the fact where economic struggles are there, but markets are a function of a lot more other things than just economics at times, because pricing, how much of the stock price is priced because of the economic risk and et cetera, and a lot of reasons. And some sectors could benefit from the current crisis. So that is where we look at price action to govern where the trends are. So this was the best period, and this was the period where the small cap index went from closer to 12,000 to 20,000 in a year. So that's like almost a 70-80% move in less than roughly 10 to 12 months. So this is your best period. Then the trend changes. But this was a weird period. So this was a period of relative strength in the Nifty and the small caps taking a knock. So this was our big learning. So one of my thumb rules which was there before was, till the time a big major swing low has not been broken for the Nifty, I will not increase a lot of cash beyond a percentage in the portfolio. And this gave me a terrible whack, because this is where we got some of the worst say drawdowns, and we are still struggling out of it. Because what happened is, the Nifty did not break the 10,000 mark, which was the last major swing low between 2018 to 2020, but the small cap index kept on making new lows. Every time there was a positive divergence, there would be a 20% pop on the small cap index, and then the Nifty would fall. And finally, just before COVID, we had a nice channel breakout on the small cap index, although the Nifty was still there. And then COVID happened, and then we went into a whack. So markets tend to surprise you in various ways. So this is something which you can't. So this was a mistake in terms of learning, or this was also a learning. You can call it a mistake or a learning, because market teaches you various ways. When you have had a great 5 years, does not imply the next 3 years will also be great. So if you're a small cap investor, there will be periods of super returns and there will be period of super drawdowns. So this is a fact. So why do I say this is a fact? Is most people want a return of small cap with a drawdown of large cap. That is not going to happen. So people want 40-50% CAGR with a drawdown of 15%. That is not going to happen, or with a drawdown of 20%. So that's the reality. So this was the new learning, as that we have to also start looking at BSE small cap and the mid cap indices on their own, and not just the benchmark indices. Because every time there was a divergence and a catch up, this did really well. So the small caps went up 20% every time there was a divergence, but then the Nifty cracked and they cracked more. Now look at the difference in, say, COVID. One may not have understood at March, but this crossing the intermediate highs in June, July was your indication of a trend change. So that is where you started making higher tops and higher bottoms. And now why am I talking a lot about small caps and mid caps? Even if you look at the small cap index today, from a peak of 20,000, it is still down at 15,000 odd levels. And a lot of small caps are still down 30 to 70%. And not all would be bad. So today, a section of small caps has done really well, but there is a whole section of stocks which are still down big time from the highs of 2017-18. And this zone for the small cap index is a 2-year resistance. Now, when this someday breaks out over the next few weeks, months together, there will be a lot of opportunities, a lot of trading opportunities, a lot of investment opportunities. Why do I say so? Is, say, when this 2-year high crossed in 2014, I'm not talking about this breakout, this 2-year high zone, which was a problem zone, then you got a superb run for the next 6-8 months. Same way, when you crossed this high, which was again a 2-year high on the small caps, we had a nice run for the short term, then a bigger run. So we are on verge of a longer term breakout. Even if there is a correction out here in the interim, over the next 1 to 3 year period, there could be very strong moves on the small caps. And that is where a lot of trading and investing opportunities will jump up. So that's why we need to create thumb rules and look out for how to trade the small caps and the mid caps. So this is where we focused on what should be there in the breakouts. Now we try to look at only the periods of, which I call the best possible periods for small caps, which is where there is a longer term breakout on the major indices, and also a major bottom has been made in the BSE small cap. When I say a major bottom has been made, is where a lot of criteria has been solved. So a positive divergence has been done. What I mean divergence is Nifty has sees at 100 and then it is at, say for out here, the Nifty is out here at 4,500. By this time, it is at 1,500, 5,500. But between 2011 to 13, the BSE small cap actually made a new low. So this is a classical major bottoming out signal, a major pessimism signal. And then this breakout happens. So that tells you this is a multi-year bull market starting for the small cap. So this is the period where it is the golden period. So this is where you get your first indication. And this is where the 52-week high happens for the BSE small cap. So that's the period where majority of the money is made, not just in the next 6 months, but maybe in the next 1 to 3 years. Same way, the next breakout similarly happens is in demonetization. Now notice, before demonetization, the small cap index actually went on to make a new 52-week high. And that is where we got the divergence on the opposite side, where the Nifty is struggling, but the small cap is making new high. So this was scary. So this is where you got a drop in demon. But then later on, you get a new all-time high on the Nifty. And it's also close to an all-time high for the small cap. Then you get one superb year. Similarly, going forward, someday, we'll get into a structural breakout here. So we've gone back to 12,400, but we've not seen similar breakouts in a lot of major indices. So what we see is over the next few weeks, months, there could be a trending move starting in the small caps also. And even if there is relative strength, which we've started seeing going forward, there will be a lot of structural opportunities as well. So there are two best times where you make money on the small caps. When there is what I call this as Nifty's in higher top, higher bottoms, small caps and mid caps are in higher tops and higher bottoms, and relative strength in small caps and mid caps. And the best period is where there is a multi-year high, a long-term breakout on the Nifty, and a major, say, panic bottom has been done in the small cap. So if you look at the major panic bottom in terms of the small caps is when we went to 9,000 Nifty, that was the same price we were in 2016 or even in 2011. And the markets had dropped almost 55-60%, the BSE small cap. Now we go to the other side. Okay, now we've understood where we want to participate. So right now is a good time to start looking at participating in small caps and mid caps, because there is no divergence with the Nifty. There more the BSE small cap index is more near a breakout. The Nifty is still in a strong trend. It is in a higher top and a higher bottom formation. So now we go to the next part is when to get out, right? So if we can do this, and I mean to say when to get out does not mean you get out 100% of your book. You can go to 10% cash, 40% cash, 60% cash. That's your side. But this signals, which I will be talking about next, are some of the best signals, which will give you a early exit from the markets, not just for small caps, but even for large caps and even as an equity exposure. So we call it the BSE small cap and the Nifty divergence. And I've written about this. So I've written an article in 2017, December, talking about it. And same in 2016, January, as to how things are, etc. So it's not something which I'm talking in hindsight. I've actually written about this particular pattern and say observations in previous years also. So most of the things which we'll talk about is, say, for example, when I talk about the learnings of 2018 to 20, we've taken the hit because of it. So we'll talk about what really is and not something which is just like a post-mortem report. So what happens in this BSE small cap and Nifty divergence when you want to increase cash? The BSE small cap is going crazy and bonkers. Gade ud rahe. You are seeing unknown names flying off. Companies with the terrible, say, past performance, terrible history are going up like crazy. They're up 50% in a month, 100% in 2 months. The BSE small cap is doing a 3x move to the Nifty. Now, what I mean to say a 3x move is, say, the Nifty is only up 5%. The BSE small cap is up 15-20%. The Nifty is down 5% and the BSE small cap is up 10-15%. So basically, the BSE small cap is outperforming Nifty by a 3x margin. Nifty is then the other way is Nifty is struggling to make new highs, but the small cap continues to make new highs. So this is the worst indication, because that tells you there is euphoria in the broader markets. And this can last 2-3 attempts in few weeks. let us look at the example and through charts. And why do we look at the BSE small cap index? Now, nobody looks at BSE anymore, right? Because hardly anyone trades in BSE. So there was a time 15 years back, 10 years back, where you used to look at the Sensex, used to remember Sensex levels in terms of supports and resistances and not Nifty. Even though Nifty was the tradable index, because Sensex was a much more better indication at those times. But now it's become only Nifty. But what we've realized is there is no other index like BSE Small Cap Index. So this is an index which is designed to represent the bottom 15% of the total market cap of the S&P BSE Small Cap. And BSE All Caps. So basically, so the index is designed to represent the small cap segment of India's stock market at any point of time. So basically what happens in all the other indices, all the other indices are survivorship based. What I mean to say survivorship based is Suzlon is part of the index. The stock starts underperforming. It gets out of that index. You Reliance Communication is the seventh largest weight in the Nifty in 2007. It keeps getting off and today it is not even there. So it's a survivorship index. So back in 2007, you had Unitech having a higher weight than HDFC Bank. Reliance Communication was the seventh largest weight in the Nifty. So a lot of these companies which are part of the Nifty in those times are now extinct. So that's a survivorship index where anything which becomes underperforms gets out of the index. Now come to BSE Small Cap. It's the other way around. A lot of companies which fall off from being a mid cap to a small cap come here. And if they go into the bottom 15% of the total market cap. So out here, there is no limit to the number of stocks. So for example, if you look at the Nifty Small Cap 100, it limits to 100 stocks. You look at Nifty, it limits to 50 stocks. Here, there is no limit. So as of now, the index has 678 stocks. I've seen there were 850 stocks, 880 stocks also before. So basically, that's a huge number of stocks and very diversified in terms of the tail. Look at it, like say there are only 1400 to 1500 really active stocks on the NSE on a single particular day. So in that sense, having an index of 678 stocks tells you that, and this is the bottom run. So this is like the worst possible, so companies which could be good to the worst, but really small size. And when these names are doing really well, that's an indication that there is a lot of froth in the markets. Now look at it, it is still at the same price that it was in 2007. The Nifty may be up, say 2x of it, but this is still at the same price as it was in 2007. Because it is not a survivorship index, it is like a dead man walking index. So this gives you the best indication of froth and pessimism in the system. So now look at this example, and if you can go through this and if you can use this rule over the next, say, whole decade, it will be superbly useful. So again, blue one is the Nifty, the red one is the BSE Small Cap. So this is the end of 2007. So you have a lower top on the Nifty, right out here, and then a marginal higher top and a marginal higher top. But look at the Small Cap Index. It makes a new high, then a new high, then a new high. So there are at least 2 to 4 new highs in that period. The Nifty is struggling to make a 5 to 10% move. The small cap index has gone up 40%. Also in this period, it's almost gone up 80 to 100% in a period of less than 6 to 8 months between the mid of 2007 to the end of 2007. So that's what we call as craziness, where stocks are going on circuits together. And say a funny joke, I don't know many people, those who would remember back then, but there used to be stocks where it used to go to 20% one day, next day 20%, and the third day another 10%. So one of the jobbing trades was buy any stock which is hitting a circuit at 20%, just drops off, goes down to 18%, buy it. Next day, you never know, it will go up another 20%. And by the time you get delivery, it will be up another 10%. So that's the kind of trades we used to take in a lot of people and used to work. So you could buy anything which is moving and it did really well. So for one of the natural resources company went up from 25 to 200 in a period of what? 6 to 8 months. Where absolutely nobody had an idea what the business was. So this is the period where anything and everything is moving. And this is the period you don't want to exit. You want to exit on the way up slowly, right? So if you say out here, the things are bad, then you will get sucked in at some point of time. So you cannot be out of it here. So you cannot be out of it here when the things have become crazy, because majority of the money is made, returns are made when it gets crazy. So when this happens, that is the time you start increasing cash. And the first rule is no more new money to be put. So when you get a BSE small cap and a Nifty divergence, you say first rule is I'll not put new money into the markets. So no new equity will go into the markets. No new cash will go into the markets. If I have SIPs, I'll stop SIPs. I'll just do nothing new. Second, I'll start increasing cash. And that is where you generally get few weeks and a couple of months. So it's not something where you have to decide the next day the markets will start falling. Rather, this is a period where you will keep being in disbelief for kitna bhagega chalega. But you have to keep the discipline on in terms of increasing cash. Then the opposite of it would be what? The Nifty remains at the same place, or rather higher bottoms. But what has happened to the small cap? It has made 3-4 new lows. So 1, 2, and 3. So there are 3 new lows on the BSE small cap. So that's an indication of pessimism in the market. Now, when that happens, that tells you a major bottom is in place. So this was the period between October to March 2009, where the markets, the Nifty was at the same place. Sensex was at 8,000 to 9,000 bottom zone. But the small caps kept on making new lows. And when you say kept on making new lows, the index was already down 70%. It went another, say, it went down to 75%, 78% from net. But that implied you've gone down another 15% over the next 6 months. And then when the price turns, that is your indication of a trend change, which we've looked at before. Now look at 2015 to 16. How this particular pattern gave you enough indication?
So I would like to just interrupt for 1 second. I'm extremely sorry. If possible, sir, can you just click on the button next to the mute button, the down arrow next to the mute button, and put your audio on the system settings? Like I've just sent you a WhatsApp as well. Okay, you're using from the browser, that is why it is not an issue, sir. Not an issue. A few people were having voice issues, but the recording is coming clear. So yeah, please continue. Whatever the issues. Sorry, sir.
So there will be a little lag at times online in most of the webinars. So because there will be a little lag because there's a Bluetooth connection for the voice, but you can just wait out. Many a times there is latency at your end if you are listening to the webinar. So this happens at times. So it's not something where the system is down all the time. Why do I say so? So just to talk about it, that why you should be at the right place at the right time. So my first YouTube video was in 2008, and my first webinar was in 2009, and there were not enough bandwidth to actually people to be looking at it. So be patient and go through it and say. A lot of these, so most of the presentation is very self-explainable. And if you have any, say, queries, you can always send in a mail across. So let us look at this indication of BSE small cap and Nifty. I'll try to be a little slow in my speech, so the lag will be taken care of. All right. So the BSE small cap and the Nifty. Again, the BSE small cap in red on top, the Nifty in the bottom. So what we are looking out in terms of divergence is there is a lower top on the Nifty and a higher top on the BSE small cap. So this is an indication of froth in the system in the near term. Because ideally, we want most small caps to do well when the Nifty is doing well, right? Or the Nifty is flat. But when the Nifty is struggling, the small caps making a new high tells you there is a lot of frothy moves happening. There's a lot of speculation happening in small caps. So that is where you get a nice 15-20% dip on the Nifty. And also the small caps take a dip down. Same thing happens here. The Nifty is making a lower top. The small cap index makes a new 52-week high again. And then it drops a 15-20%. Then finally, this has happened a couple of times. And in this period, just because the small cap is in an uptrend, you want to only focus on relative strength. Then there are three lower tops on the Nifty, But there are three higher tops on the BSE small cap. And also it is going very close to a 52 week high, where the Nifty is down from 9,000 to 8,000 to 7,800. So that's like the Nifty is down 12% and this is down nothing in that same period. Rather, it is up 5%. So that's like a 3x move over a period of time. And then comes the big correction in February 2016. That is the time when the rumors of a long-term capital gains in equity came in, which came after 2 years. So, but this is where we saw a fall on a lot of rumors. And these are interesting times. Why do we look at a lot of divergences? Because say, for example, we made a bottom on what? The 29th February, when we had budget. The earlier bottom here was on 14th February 2016. But the global indices actually made a bottom here. And by this time, when we were here, the global indices were already up 10%. So that's why a lot of event risk, which we look at, tends to surprise us in terms of what we are looking at in terms of our sense. So the global markets had already given an indication we should bounce back. And why do I say so is this is a divergence indication which gives you some of the very superb signals. And the BSE small cap makes a new low, new closing low. And this is the time where what happened is, when you go to Google Analytics, Google Trends, we searched for a word called multi-bagger. And multi-bagger as a word actually hit a relative high to 2007 in terms of the search trends. So by 2016, everybody wanted a multi-bagger, because 2013 to 2016, a lot of stocks had gone up 5x, 10x. So everybody wanted a multi-bagger by then. And also a lot of search trends changed. Suddenly Bangalore came up in the top of the picture in terms of, so Karnataka used to not be the first three states searching for stocks, but by 2016, it was Karnataka on the first or the second place. So I actually shared an article in January 2016 talking about how multi-baggers has hit a new high, and this is not the great time. Then we got a nice correction in this period. So such simple indications, more database approach rather than our thinking bias. Then 2016, we actually came out also with a note. There's a YouTube video also where I presented how it would be one of the best times to buy. Then cut to 2016 and what happens? We have US elections. Then the Nifty has fallen from 8,900 to 8,600. Before the date of the election, we are actually breaking down this low. So November 1st week itself, we are breaking the previous lows at 8,600 Nifty. What has happened to the small cap index in that 2 months period between September mid to November? They've made 3 to 4 new highs. Now that's something which is scary. So in the same way around when, say in the last few weeks, whenever people have asked me about how are you looking at the elections? I said, I don't know what will happen in terms of, but it's not as scary as before. Why? Because the divergence was the other way around. Nifty was making higher tops. Small caps were at the same place. So that's not a divergence which can kill the markets. So that's a divergence which can surprise or not surprise or do nothing. So this is what was happening. And then the elections coincided with demonetization. So we had a nice drop on the small caps as well as the Nifty. So that was your indication to increase cash, and you get nice 1 to 2 month period where you can do that. So it's not something this signal. So this divergence lasts really quite a few weeks. Then you get a nice reversal here, higher tops, higher bottom formation starting again. So this is the way we look at it, the same way we looked at it in 2017. So that's a study which I would say as a homework for everyone who's attending this. You'll notice in the end of 2017, the Nifty was struggling to make new highs around the 10,000 odd mark, but the small cap index started making new highs. And that was the indication where it was a little frothy. A lot of, so I got that right, but we got smacked because in 2018, we took an entry early. And then whatever we entered took a real, real bad hit. So, but at least we got a little better because we had gone to increase cash in 2017 and no new investments were made between 2017 to 2020. So that's the big difference. If you can get that right. So for example, why do I talk about when to increase cash and when to increase equity? Consider this. why do we need to increase cash in, say, 2017 or in 2007 or in 2016 after the correction? Because what happens is, if we don't have enough cash, and which has been a problem in COVID for a lot of us, because that came out of nowhere. So there was no major signal in terms of the markets correcting. A lot of perma bears would have got it right, because they've been bearish all through 2015 to 2018, between 2018 to 2020. And the Nifty went up another 25-30% ever since they were bearish. But in the real sense, there was nothing there. But what happens is, say, consider you sold in 2015. In the bottom of 2016, even if you have 10% cash or 20% cash, or you have new money which you've saved and you've not put into the markets, you will be able to buy the new leaders. So what happened in COVID is, now you have a stock which is down quite a lot because of COVID, and that stock also has a potential to double, and you have a pharma stock also which has a potential to double in terms of logical sense. But because you are already invested in X stock, how do you sell the X down 50% and buy the Y one and expecting this to do better? But when the signals come in and you've increased cash, you have cash, so you don't consider X to Y, you'll only buy Y, which is the new leader. And that is where we need to look at this increasing cash and increasing equity, because in every new cycle, there will be new leaders. So when we use this particular, say, signal, that will give you some of the best opportunities. One, to book profits. Second, when the next cycle happens, you are on the new leaders. You're not stuck on things which have changed. So a lot of business changes happen. Say, for example, after 2020, a lot of businesses will now take much longer. So a casino business will take 2-3 years to actually go back to the same place. So now your question is whether you buy Delta Corp at 60-70 or you buy an API company, right? But if you're already owning Delta Corp, then you are in a very big soup. But this was COVID, but in the all previous corrections, you got very, very superb signals where you could have turned that, say, increased cash. And also, why do I talk about this is, if you have made good money in 2014 to 17, you can take care of the next correction. You've made good money between 2005 to 2007, you can digest 2008. So there's a saying, ke teji mein itna loot lo ke mandi se farak na pade. So that is where you make so much money in a bull market that a big drawdown in a bear market does not kill you. It just hurts you. But you survive the next cycle, and then again in the next cycle, you go up much, much bigger. So this is where I've made it clear when to trade the small caps, when to increase equity, and then when to increase cash. If these two things only, if you can take back home and focus only on this, even if you have a mutual fund portfolio, you have an equity portfolio which is diversified, you have somewhere else, you've given some money to somewhere else, you'll be able to decide when to increase cash and when to increase equity. Now, the next part of the session, we are only going to talk about what are the good times to trade small caps and how to trade them. So now we've decided when to trade small caps. So for example, the last, since June, July, it has been a good time to trade small caps. Relative strength, because small caps started sulking around September mid onwards. So September to November was a period to be selective. Now again, if the small cap index starts making new highs, that would again be a good time to start looking at small caps. So now we go to some of the most, so there are various patterns which you can look at, but now we'll go to a problem in terms of what patterns to look out for. So before we start that, we'll take a 1 minute break. I'll take a little break for a minute, have a little water. So we start again in 2 minutes.
Sir, until a break, I'll just brief people about the Finvent's platform. Okay, guys, so as you all know, just a second. Okay, guys, so as you all know, today's is being by Finvents. We are trying to reinvent financial literacy. It's a very big thing to say, but we are trying our best to do it. Basically, the event is how to trade in mid caps and small caps. Using technical analysis, our presenter is Mr. Nuresh Mirani. He is an institution in himself. He does not need an introduction. He has already given an introduction, but we consider him an institution. So, my name is Ayush. My co-moderator is Abhimanyu Ola. So, about FinVents, our journey till now, we have an active mailing list of around 1800 members. For whom we have conducted 9 events till now. Actually, we did around 10 events, but we are excluding an event for some compliance reasons. And now, our platform has different memberships, from a free membership to a paid membership. And basically, we are offering the paid membership and title is you will get to attend 36 paid events in 2021. All free events you will get to attend in 2021. You will get access to all the free as well as the paid events. You will get access to the notes as well. Am I audible, guys? Just use the chat. If I'm audible, please use the chat box and tell me. Okay, perfect. In our annual membership, basically, there was a break in between. That was my fault. Sorry, there was a break in between. In our annual membership, you will get access to 36 paid events and access to all our free events, and you will get access to all the event recordings for 2020 as well as 2021. And on our social network, you will get a blue tick profile like you have on Twitter and Facebook. Basically, we are going to produce some in-house business case studies, so you will get access to that. Then we'll be giving the next year membership for free. We'll be holding case study contest for that. So it will basically be like you'll get auto enrollment into those contests, and you'll get dedicated WhatsApp as well as email support. Now the charges, as most of you are asking, it was 4500 which we decided, but then our launch charges was 3000 which we have reflected on our website. So the early access is even a 500 rupees discount on that. So basically it comes to somewhere around 2500. Now if you are interested, I'm not saying you have to do this, but if you are interested in that, so you can simply go to finvents.in and you will get a payment link on how to go about it and how to participate in our early access program. And the payment link will be available to you. Abhimanyu is in the chat box. He will guide you, or whoever wants to subscribe, he will guide you. Nuresh sir, if you are ready, the 2500 is still December 2021. So okay, so sir, if you are ready, then I can hand over the control to you again. Okay, these are our list of speaker guys for 2021. This is a tentative list. This is a tentative list, basically. This is a tentative list. This list may be subject to change. And all their events may not be paid. Some of our speakers are honorary speakers. Their events will be free, but we are not disclosing it right now. We will disclose it after 14th of November. So, and those events which will be free, we will also not be charging you, because just a second. Sir, I'm making you the presenter. Whenever you're ready, we can. Sir, I made you the presenter. Okay, guys, I think Nuresh sir will still take 2-3 minutes, but until then, your voice is coming, sir. Your voice is coming. I'll be on mute now.
Can you hear me? Ayush, if you can confirm, if you can hear me.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I can hear you. People are even confirming it on the chat box. Everybody can hear you. Your voice is perfectly audible, sir.
All right, yeah. So I've just tried to go to a wired, say, headphone, so maybe that will help.
So your voice was audible actually before also. There were only some people who were not able to get it, properly. So the
All
recording,
right,
it is
so
coming
let us
very
go back to the
clearly. Yeah.
presentation.
Yeah. So that is what I wanted to tell you also, that the recording is coming very clean. So the recording
Sorry,
will
sorry,
be,
sorry,
there will
sorry.
not be an issue for the record. Yeah.
All right.
So yeah, you can continue. Yes, sir.
Great. So I think now the audio will be much better. That's what I wanted to do, just in case the wired headphone makes a little difference. I think if I take it a little far, I think now it should be much better. Great.
Yes, sir.
All right. So let me get back to the presentation again. So now we look at, say, what technical chart patterns to look out for when in a breakout scenario for small caps. There are various chart patterns which we can look out for. We'll look at some chart patterns where the risk reward is great. The move can be faster than expected. So the best case, what you want in small caps is it moves out 20, 30, 50% really fast, and the stop losses are not more than 5 to 10%. So this is where we are trying to focus on a few patterns where it works. The one pattern is called a symmetrical triangle, wherein what happens in a symmetrical triangle
Sir, the
is
screen you've
the
not
range
shared, I think.
contracts. So whatever is the range, say a stock has been contracting in a range.
Sir,
Now,
the
when does
screen
the
share is
breakout
not
take
on,
place?
I think.
So the theoretical rule says, it says once you take this trend lines, take it to the apex around 60 to 70% size. But
Sir.
here we try to use common sense. What is the range where the stock cannot be? So for example, Reliance cannot be in a 3% range,
Sir,
right?
your screen is not
But
sharing.
a small cap cannot be in a 10% range. So whenever you think the range has contracted a lot, there could be an explosive move. Then you wait for price action. Confirmation with volumes is very important because a symmetrical triangle theoretically can break on either side. Now in small caps, we can't short the other side, so we only wait for price action to confirm. And if there is volume, so the volumes has to be more than, say, if the previous day volume is 100K share, 1 lakh shares, it better be more than 2 lakh shares, or at least 50 to 100% higher, ideally 3 to 4x the previous day's volume or the last 2 weeks' average volume. Sorry, I just went back to the presentation. I forgot screen sharing.
Not an issue, sir. Not an issue. I was trying to tell you
So
actually, who I think kuch audio
I'll just
disturbance ho
share
raha
the
tha.
whole
Yes, sir.
screen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
All right. Sorry, I just goofed up a bit.
No,
So
sir.
I just went back to the main
We
screen. I did
make
not
bigger
realize
goof
that I
ups,
haven't
sir.
shared. Now I
Yes, sir.
think
We make
the
bigger
screen is
goof ups.
sharing
Yes.
fine. My
Yes, sir.
video
Yes,
as well as
sir.
the audio is fine.
Yes, sir. Screen is sharing. Yes, screen is not sharing, sir.
So I just took a break to get a wired headphone so that maybe the Bluetooth is taking a little lag. I think this is the best we can do. I think we can't have anything more than this.
Sir, we are already indebted.
Great.
You have given us so much time on a weekend. So, we
All
cannot,
right.
say yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So I'll again start off with the same part which I'm talking about. So I'm talking about a symmetrical triangle. Now I'll just repeat whatever I've said. So what is a symmetrical triangle? The range is contracting. So for example, you are making a higher bottoms and a lower top. The range is contracting. Theoretically, the breakout happens at 60 to 75% of the size. So where you extend the trend line, this is where the trend lines join, 60 to 75% of the size. Now this is theoretical. But you have to use common sense because you can't be taking a scale and putting or say doing out ratios. whenever the range is really small, that is the time it would break out. So for example, a large cap like Reliance or Asian Paints, etc., cannot be in a 3% range or a 4% range. So that's the time it is getting really close. Same way a small cap cannot be in a 5 to 10% range. So when it becomes, the range is so contracted, that is the time you start tracking that stock very closely. And in a symmetrical triangle, breakout can happen on the either side. So it can also be a breakdown. But in small cap, you can't go short. So you're only focusing on the breakout. So the price action is there and the volumes are supporting. So when the volumes are supporting, what do I want the volumes? The, yesterday's volume is 1 lakh shares. Today, I would like to, it to be 150, 200K shares or 3 to 4X the normal volume. So I would like it to be a 3, 4 lakh volume. Many a times the breakout is happening in the day. So maybe the breakout is happening at 1 o'clock. Half the day is over. So I would like by that time only 2 lakh shares are done. So obviously it will be more than double the volumes. So that's the criteria which we look out for. So price and volumes. Extremely important to focus on volumes. The target is the base of the triangle. So which is from this. So you can keep it simple. Take this low and take this high. And if you want to take a little shorter term target, take this low and this high and subtract the difference. So that's your target. So that's your target one. This is your target two. Now, if you want a more detailed explanation on this, you can Google it or I have a free ebook on my website. You can go through it. It explains this purely theoretically as to how it works. So a triangle pattern formation, symmetrical triangle. The other one is a ascending triangle. In an ascending triangle, what is happening? There is higher bottoms, but not a higher top. So the range is contracting. There are multiple tops around the same prices and the bottoms are getting higher. So in this case, the breakout chances on the upside are higher. The lower side may not achieve the targets. So in this, the assumption is it will break out on the upside. And even if it breaks down on the downside, the trade is not great. So this works really well for a small cap. And why do we look at triangle patterns is, say, when we buy on the breakout, you'll keep a stop loss, say, if this is a 6 month pattern, we say target should be done in 1/3 of the time or lesser. So your holding period will be 1 to 2 months. So if it's a 1 to 2 month holding position, you don't want to keep a 200 day moving average stop loss. You keep a 20 day stop loss or a 50 day stop loss. So ideally a 20 day moving average stop loss to keep it simple, or you keep the last swing low as your stop loss. That would be a little deep, but 20 day moving average stop loss is a decent enough stop loss to go with triangle patterns. And the target is equal to, first is this swing, this much swing target, and the second is this much. You can take this exact triangle formations, but I would say calculating high and low because it's not an exact science. So this will give you the range where you have to book profits. Very important is price action and volume. So volumes confirmation is extremely needed. If there is no volumes, maybe we'll give it a skip or cut the site. Then there could be smaller patterns also in triangles, which are called wedges, which are called, say, flags at times. The reason we like this pattern is the stop losses are small and we try to catch early because here we are already ready before the breakout happens. So you can, because by the time the range is contracting, you've started tracking the stock. So you have the advantage to be able to catch it on the same day itself or on the next day itself. So you're catching it early. The stop losses are small. And that's the first pattern. So we'll take at this examples. Now, when we are talking about volumes, that's the time I would like to cover why volumes are important. So why do we look at volumes per se a lot? So let me give you an example as to why we look at volumes a lot more in India than in any other country, because the structure of Indian markets in terms of holding is very, very different. So in India, promoters own 50 to 75% of the company. Globally, it's the other way around. The institutions plus the retail individuals own 50 to 75% of the company, and the promoters end up owning 25% in or 25 to 50%. But in India, what happens is for the whole Indian equity market, the 150, 170 lakh crore market cap of India, promoters own an average of 45 to 50%. FIIs own around 20 to 25%, FIIs plus FDI. Domestic institutions, insurance plus mutual funds own around 12 to 15%. And the rest is with retail, HNI, quasi promoter holding, whatever you want to call it. But this is the structure. Now, this is not a, say, it's a very close approximation because we've done the numbers on the whole universe. And when I actually came out with a report called Flows to Floats back 3-4 years back as to why the float is really small and the flows will continue to lead to stock specific sharp movements and why a small float is interesting if the earnings are great, but we've not got earnings growth in India. The day that happens, the craziness will be at a different level. So this is the number, but what happens is when we go down, trickle down to the mid cap and small cap companies, many promoters own 50 to 75%, and another 5 to 10%, 2 to 5% is with their family and friends. And in some cases, institutions own another 10%. So the ideal weight many times is between 4 to 10%, which is purely float. Now what happens is, in terms of value also, this becomes small. So for a 1,000 crore market cap company, if only 50 crores worth of float is available, now you can't buy the whole float. So even if you want to buy 2 crores worth of quantity, that will take a lot of effort in terms of price impact. So you cannot buy, say, a 1,000 crore market cap company and say, I'll buy 2% of the company so easily. You'll not be able to. You can't buy 20 crores of it. So even if you buy 2-5 crores of it, there will be a sudden impact in price. And that is where what happens is that gets captured in our data in terms of volume and price impact. And that is why we as technical analysts are able to catch this move. So somebody, an investor, an institution, or a HNI is taking a bet this small cap company could become a mid cap company over the next few years. So if the stock is at 100, me as an institution, me as an HNI would buy from 100 to 140 rupees nonstop, whatever quantity is available till the time I've got my quantity. So that 40%, 50% impact cost, which an investor is taking, thinking the stock would be 500 over the next 5 years or 300 to 500, is our profit for the short-term trader, even for a medium-term trader. And even in the long term, you are going in with someone who's convinced, who's done his work. So the impact is super clear, and there is no way to hide volume. See, people say there is operation, etc. But the fact is, stock prices can go up when people are buying the stock and there are lesser. So that is simple demand and supply. And when the supply is very, very limited, it gets very easily seen on the chart. So that's why, as a technical analyst, you have a superb advantage in terms of catching a lot of small caps really early when the volumes have started. Similarly, on the downside, the impact is super clear, as a price point does not need volumes as much as upside. So this is where we cover a very interesting topic in our online courses, which is how to look at price volumes on the downside. So for example, how pharma stocks saw a 5x, 10x volume downticks in 2015, and the next 5 years were gone. Satyam, Crompton, and various such companies, Dewan Housing. So on the downside, the impact is super clear. The only problem is the price falls off 20-30% on the same day. But on the upside, what happens is, see, panic is really fast. So fear is like a virus which flows out really fast. But optimism is not very fast. So even on something good happening, the prices don't go up 50%. But if there is something real bad and everyone knows about it, there will be no buyer. So the reason technical analysis works a lot is that when everything is convincing, it may not happen in a few hours. But if it's scary, you'll dump the stock first. So when we say sell first, think later, when there is a bad news, and which you understand and the markets are yet to understand. So that's why momentum investing works, is because people do not become negative to positive in an instant, but you can become positive to negative in an instant, because that is how we have been built. So if, like, say, if you read old, say, a book like where Sapiens, where it will talk about how if you hear a lion's roar, you have to run. You can't think where the lion is coming from. You have one direction you are listening to the voice, you have to go to the other three different directions wherever you can run. So that's how we are inbuilt. So fear will take supersedence any point of time. And that's why we look at volumes a lot, and that is our advantage. Now, when I take you through examples, try to focus it through common sense, and then you'll understand how this works. So this is a chart of IFB Industries. We've taken examples mostly of the last few months so that everyone has a little bit of a memory. We have examples over the last many years, but the last few months, so that would have a memory in terms of somebody would have seen those prices, etc. So now look at this stock, IFB Industries. After a good fall in March, which happened at everything, first recovery, then keeps getting slower, and then you see out here, the range gets really tight. And this is where the breakout happens. And look at the volumes. We don't go to exact numbers, just visually see it. You can easily see this is 3 to 5 times the previous day's volumes, and also on an average. So that's an indication of a price volume breakout. So you have a breakout here as well as here. So you get any of these days where you buy, you have your stop loss placed at the 20-day moving average. Your target is this size. So this is what happened next to the stock. Price breaks out, does both the size targets and continues to do well, and the stock is still doing well. Now understand, the first move happened, then there is a dip, and then comes the big move. Now a lot of people in this 10% correction get fizzled out. So either you book partial profits here and ride one. So for us, it was a small trade. We booked out at the first 12-15% move because that was the trade, and we missed out on the next one. So you got to decide that you are taking the whole target or you want to get out on the smaller targets. And it does not imply the day it breaks out, the next day onwards, this will keep going. There will be a few days where the stocks tend to be very sideways. And sometimes it could go below the line also, but your stop losses will not be hit. So one mistake in small cap, say breakout trading or any breakout trading, is people expect after the breakout, the prices should not come back lower. Now, if it was a one-way street, then everybody would make money, right? Just buy a new high, buy, and it will just keep going up. The fact is, you bought at 100, the stock can go to 96. The breakout is at 100. Your stop loss is at 92, 94. Till the time it does not trigger your stop loss, the stocks can do whatever they want. You have to wait. So this is where a lot of people will chicken out in the next day, saying no follow-up, nothing, and then the stock moves up. Another small example, Hindustan Oil Exploration, will take a lot of examples. Now in this case, a big fall, recovery. Can you see the range is so tight, barely a 2 rupee range. That's like a 5% range for a stock. And then you see double the volumes on this breakout. See, the price started moving up here. This is the day it breaks out. So that's your clear indication, as cross the intermediate swing, also the triangle. So now you have a small stop loss. Your upside is this full triangle size, right? The contracting range. Now look at what happens to the stock. The stock continues, does your target from 45 to 60. That's like a 40% move really fast. The stock went up to 75 quickly and then eventually 95 also. And then this is where it gave you another breakout. If you put a triangle here. And then the volumes keep on increasing. The next example, Nippon Asset Management India. Now look at this case. This is a small triangle. Also, it has created a base by making a same, taking support at the same prices. Although a bottom reversal would have been much higher, that would be too late. Now look at the volume change. The volume is double on the day of the breakout. So your target is what? 260 is the high, 220 is the low. So you're looking at a 40 rupee target. That's like a 15-20% move. And that is where you get out. And look at what happened to the stock. In this case, first 2 days move dips, and then people say, "Ye chala nahi," and then it does the move totally. So it will never be a clean ride all the time. There will be some cases where there will be a clean ride, but you have to assume that if you are buying a 4 month breakout, you'll have to keep it for a month. The next breakout did not work out, so even if you bought here, you will get stopped out here after some time. Another example, Welspun Corp, sharp fall, terrible COVID hit. Look at the volumes, goes up 3x. Then so this is like huge volumes on this 2 days, slight range contraction. Then the breakout happens, goes from 5860 to 8090 very quickly. Another range contraction, breaks out, again goes back. So it gives you another move from 90 to 120. Now it has made multiple tops around 120 in the last few months, and it is at that 100 to 120 range. So the next time it breaks out for 120-25, that could be another trade. NCC, another example, sharp fall. The first falling wedge breakout happened here. The next one here, range contraction. Now this is more like a falling wedge or a falling flag, whatever you want to call it. Look at the change in volumes. This is the first day of the volume breakout, which is where you get in, and the volumes keep increasing. Now look at the move. A little bit of pause for the next three sessions, then the big move. goes from 24, 25 to 30, 35 very quickly. Again, gives you a similar trade here. And look at it as a, these are all trade opportunities which we are talking about. So these are very quick trading opportunities. So triangles are not for 3 years. So triangle formations are generally for few months and few weeks. So triangle formation is for a quick trade, a quick 20 to 50% pop and with a stop loss of 5 to 10%. Another example, a very, not a very liquid company, IIFL Securities, huge volume jump. Volume jump being 3 to 5x. Now, when you see such a price volume jump, you expect that ab to ye circuit lagega kyunki stock hi circuit wala hai. But that is not how the markets tend to behave. Look at the price action later. Goes up, dips again, does a retest, then does the bigger move. And then eventually the stock has gone from 30 to 60 in a period of 2 months. Right? But there will be volatility. When you're trading small caps, you either get one way breakouts or there will be volatility and then the trend. But when the trends break out, they generally do well, but you have to give it time. And this is not a long time I'm talking about in the breakout. Now, another example, Motilal Oswal breaks out of a triangle, decent volumes. This is the price contraction I'm talking about. Now, in this case, this was a tough one. It came almost close to breaking the entry stop losses and then made the big move. Right? So this was a tough nut. So here maybe you would have got stopped out and then the move happened, but you would not lose much because you bought at 550, you'll get stopped out at 550 because before that it has gone to 600 plus. Right? And the next time also it breaks out, you get an option, does a retest and then makes the move of 15-20%. So that was about triangles. And the reason you should look at triangles is currently, as I go through the markets today, if we go out through the markets today, there are a lot of triangle formations in small caps. I will not discuss any of them. Take a homework, go back, look at those charts. Now we take another pattern where it can be a short-term trade as well as a medium to long-term trade, which is a cup and handle pattern. Now in this case, this is not a range contraction. This is a much longer pattern. So a cup and handle pattern is for months and years together at times. So the longer the pattern, better it is. More the attempts, better it is. So there are, and this three have to be swing highs. Right, so this can't be a random point. So this is what most people will make a mistake when you see charts on various forums, is they'll take a trend line out of anywhere and call anything a cup and handle. So this ideally has to be a swing high. This has to be a swing high. This has to be a swing high. Most of the times people take a downward chart and call it a cup and handle. Because the reason why cup and handle works is, the logic here is, see, in the end, it is ideally just three tops crossing, right? Why do we call it a cup and handle? Why do we give it so much of, say, literature as to why we should focus on this chart? Is because what happens for a cup and handle is the stock goes from 100 to say 70 or say 40 or 50. It has had a 30, 50% drop. Now, many companies don't come back so easily to the same prices. So we've seen a stock which falls 50, 70%. Many of them never come back. So the ones which can come back implies they've gone through a valuation cycle. They've gone through a bad business cycle. They've gone through some bad economy. Something has gone wrong and they've survived. So that company has survived fundamentally. Then it comes back to the same price. Now, a lot of people, those who are stuck before, will get out here, or there is still disbelief that the company has survived. Then it takes a dip, goes from this price, takes a little dip. So in this case, say this is 120 to 80. Then again from 120 goes to 100. And then finally breaks out about 120. And this could be the time which could coincide with a perception change on the business, valuation re-rating, earnings growth, and a lot of positive things happening. Most of the times you've noticed cup and handles coincide with a lot of fundamental changes which could be happening now or maybe a few months later. So many a times you'll see a breakout here and superb earnings here. So what do you do in a cup and handle? Now, that's why we don't take a random swing, say, a random starting point, because a cup and handle of this formation implies there has been a change in the company and that's why prices are moving. We have to accept the part. Technical analysts don't create prices, or technical analysis patterns are not. These are understanding of what actually is the market talking about the stock, or what is the perception changing on the stock, and that
perception is defined by the business of the company or the sectoral tailwinds, headwinds, whatever you want to call it. So it is very rare a business keeps on losing money and is going bankrupt and the stock prices will go up 500 times, five times, right? So ideally, in most cases, common sense tells you what? The business does well, or say things change, that is why people buy the stock and that goes up. So that is how we look at markets. Technical analysts, when we are trying to buy at 120, is we are following someone who's taken some institution, some HNI has taken the bet, the times have changed for this company. And they may buy up till 140, 160. So their impact cost is our profits. Remember this, a short-term trade in small caps, your profit is somebody's impact cost. Now that is, if you understand that, that is where your trade logic will change a lot more. Then you will not ask, why is the stock going up? Is there a trigger? Somebody could be talking about a trigger 2 years down the line or 1 year down the line and buying today. Right? Again, why do we like this pattern is, now this longer the pattern, better it is. If it is an all-time high, the best case. Multi-year high, best case. So a multi-year high with an all-time high, you can also preempt at times, because that could be an indication someday it has to break out. The stop losses are small in terms of the targets being really big. Now the difference here is, this is the only pattern, like in most technical patterns, I would like to have volume confirmation. But in cup and handle, I'll be okay with giving a volume confirmation out, because what happens in a cup and handle is, I don't want to miss a 50, 100, 200% investment or a trade for trying to save a 6 to 8% stop loss. So I'm better off giving an 8% stop loss than missing out a 50% trade. Because one such stop loss hit is equivalent to one good hit in such a stock is equivalent to 5 stop losses being taken care of. But most of the time, we as traders try to focus on being right more. Now, if you want to become a better trader, change your thinking. Change towards how much do I make when I go right? And that will be. So if you make a 50% trade, that will take care of even a 10% stop loss, 5 of your mistakes. So what do you want to reduce? 5 mistakes, or you want to get one good right? So that is where your focus should be. And that's why I like cup and handles, because small stocks, big targets, and they tend to surprise a lot. Now, we'll take examples only. So this is Supreme Petro. Now, very interesting, the company is able to cross pre-COVID highs in August itself. So that tells you something has changed for the business, something has changed for the perception. And volumes are again 3x the breakout. Now look at it, what happens? Your size is the handle size and the cup size, which both got done. Then you will see it was a move wherein other petrochemical stocks like Manali Petro also went up 50%. So this is an indication of a sectoral trend also. So the stock goes from 200 to 270. Another example, Natco Pharma. This is a sloping cup and handle, good volume breakout. Pharma is already leading the sector from April itself. Now look at it. The move was not easy. It took a few weeks before the big move came in. And the big move is it went up 50% over the next 3 months. So it's not going to be easy always. Another example, Unichem Labs. This was an interesting example where promoters bought from the open market at an average price of 135. And in this 4 days, promoters bought 50% of the delivery volume. So we look at insider trading very closely. So this is where it came on our radar, that the promoter has been so desperate because the stock has more cash than the market cap. So we waited for a breakout and we got in at 140, 145. And then the stock went up this way. Now look at it. It is not easy. The volatility is always there. The stock goes from 140 to 170, comes back to 150, then goes to 170, then 150, then 180, then 165, then 200, then 180, and then goes to 280. Right, so it will not be an easy ride in terms of it will be a single way ride. So the stock has actually doubled in 2.5 months, but it's not a steady ride. All right. Another example, Orissa Mineral Development Corporation. nice triangle, restriction of the a very contracted volumes are 5 to 7x. Now, when you see this, acha, this is a circuit to circuit stock, you expect there will be circuits. Now, look at the price action. Makes the first move, dips, retests the breakout at 16,1650, and then goes to 3,200. Right? And this is where the good news comes in. Some good news in the company came up here. Another example, Strides Pharma. Now, this is a little longer term chart, also talking about the big cup and handle here. But if you look at it earlier, the first part is it's a small triangle. So that is where you got an entry point, huge volumes, and then it's a big cup and handle, and also a multi-year high when it crosses about 550. And the stock continues to do well. Again, look at the volatility. Goes from 600, 530, then 650, then 580. So you don't expect the moves to be clean. There will be clean moves in something like a 2007 or a 2015 or a 2017, but not all cycles will be the same. Another example, now this was the toughest one. Nice cup and handle formation, breakout with volumes, dipped back, again went up. So this is where we actually finally got, say after a month, we did not see a huge follow-up. So we got out at a 10% move and then suddenly the stock hits a 20% freeze. Now, another example which I talk about, eClerks breaks out, does the first move, does the first little swing target, and then dips. So in this case, we booked partial, and then after a month also did not do well. So we got a little time stop loss hit, and that is just bad luck because the moment we sold after 3-4 sessions, the stock went up from 500 to 800. So not always will be a clean ride. But the fact is you don't lose money because you bought at the same prices and you sold at the same prices the rest of the position. So that's our indication of volumes. Now look at this clean trade, no sell. Promoters bought from the open market here. That is where it came onto our radar. The day it breaks out, good volume change. And then the stock goes from 100 to 120. Then the next move breaks out at 135, goes to 150, still holding on. Now, not all trades will work the way you expect. So this is a company called Mangalore Chemicals Fertilizers. Nice cup and handle breakout, huge volumes, right? Volumes are nice. Now, what happened to the stock? Made another attempt and then it flopped out. So this is where you need to keep your stop losses somewhere. Otherwise, you say it's a false breakout. A false breakout is a stop loss hit. So you take your stop loss hit and get out. Now, in hindsight, we learned a little bit more on the fundamentals in terms of shareholding. So we saw economic Indian income tax department sell stock at 40, 42 levels. And in this date, it got actually covered by a business channel. For no reason, the stock went up 20%. So we sold half of your position here because we realized if there is a consistent seller which owns 15% of equity, this is the ex-Malia Group company. So that is where we got out and the rest on the way down. So not all will work the way you expect, but when you go wrong, you lose 5-10%. Same way, a nice cup and handle on ICICI Lombard breaks out. Volumes were not great, but we still went ahead. What happened to the stock? 1350, you get stopped out at 1300 levels, 20-day moving average, swing lows goes off in the stock, and that is where you take your hit. Orient Cement breaks out with volumes. A 3x volume breakout, you buy at 17. Then the max stop loss you can keep is what? The last swing low here. And the worst is this is a major swing low. So you can't have a buy at 70, 71 and not sell till 60. You get out at 67 and 65, the worst case. So, and this was also a nice cup and handle in the making. Break, broke out, stayed there for the next 3-4 days. So not all trades will go the right way. So I'm talking about some failures also. But you have to realize this is what happens. So you lose 5-10% when you go wrong. Century Enka, this was pre-COVID. Volumes 5x, 7x. Breaks out about 195, goes to 220. You expect much more to happen. And then what happens to the stock? You get stopped out here in the 20-day moving average. Worst swing case low, out you get here. So you take the stop loss hit. The fall happened much before March itself. So it was not something which got hit literally. So this is where everything is right, but you can go wrong. So understand, in technicals, you're never going to be right 100% of the time. If you're right more than 80% of the time, understand it's the market which is right. Trend superb hai. Akkad bakkad bo, jo lena hai le lo, paisa banega. And that's why the first topic I spoke about is when to be trading small caps. So when you're right 80% of the times in the market, it is not your right. The trend is super right. If you're right only 40% of the times, understand that is, say if you do even good analysis, it's not what you are wrong all the time. It could be the market is not in a great trend, it's in a sideways trend. So ideally, you will be right 60-70% of the times in a normal market when you've done enough work. And that's why you have to realize that most of your focus should be not on reducing, say you can't increase your hit rate from 60% to 70%. What you can do is when you're right, try to make more. Right. So that is where I'll end my session in terms of how do we look at in terms of analysis. Thank you a lot. So these are my contact details. If anyone has a query or anything, you can always get in touch with us. So to sum it up the session, I'll just take a very quick flash. When to trade small caps? When those 6 points, higher tops, higher bottoms, relative strength, all those things are there. When to increase cash? When there is small cap, BSE small cap to NSE Nifty divergence. Then the next part is what patterns to look out for. There are various patterns which you can look out for. We focus on two a lot more than the other patterns. Triangles and cup and handles, because there are small stop losses. Triangles are quick trades, short-term holding periods. Cup and handles are longer-term trades, larger holding period. You can also have a short-term trade as well as a longer-term trade. You can take the handle size and do it. Importance is volumes a lot in triangles, wedges, flags. You can maybe look out for a little bit of, say, a leeway when you are doing a cup and handle breakout. Now, remember one thing. When you are trading small caps, you will always have very huge moves at times, and there will be some times where you lose out. The way to trade small caps and mid caps is not trying to focus on how many times you go right. You want to get big trades right, because the fact is, and even in large caps, you want to do the same thing, but ideally in small caps, the moves are faster. So you can say in a good trend, you can make solid money. There will be long periods where things may not be as great, but one particular cycle is enough. So 2014 to 17 is enough to take care for all mistakes in 2017 to 20, because then if you can 2020 to 23, sometime 21 to 23, if you get a similar cycle, you will cover back much more than what you've lost. Because if you can avoid frauds, small cap index, even in 2008, has never fallen by about 70%. So you will have a 30, 40, 50% drawdown, even if you're purely long only without any, say, increasing cash, anything, you'll have such drawdowns. But when a year like 2014, you will get a return of 100%. So let me give you an example. We do a lot of random portfolio studies. So between 2013, I'm not talking about August bottom. If you bought in October, a random portfolio till October 2015, the random portfolio return was 130%. And it was a diversified portfolio of 25 equal weighted stocks. Same way, if you bought between 2014 to 17, your return would be 3x. So your X would have become 3x by that time, a random portfolio return. So you would have doubled your money or more between 200. So your 100 rupee would have become between 250 to 300, just randomly. So that is where you have to realize when you're trading small caps, you go from 100 to 60, 100 to 70, the next cycle you can go up to 250. And which will be still better over a 2 cycle period, which may not happen in large caps. Now, consider this. If in the coming cycles forward, if you can use what we've talked about today, you will be cutting your drawdowns by increasing cash. You will be magnifying your returns because you will be trading small caps a lot more between 2014 to 17. And a lot lesser between 2017 to 2019-20. So this is where I wanted to talk about this. Rest, everything about me is available on the website. Whatever training programs, I'll not talk about that. Thanks a lot, everyone. We can take questions now.
So if you want, we'll take a 2 minutes break and we'll just brief everyone about FinVents, and after that, you know, without sharing the screen, we can start the Q&A, and whatever you feel is like comfortable, you can either pick up the questions
so
randomly. Okay, so if you want, we can start the Q&A
right now. Ayush, you can let us know how do we want to take questions, I think, from the chat box, I suppose.
Yes, sir. From the chat box only, we'll be taking the questions. But I wanted to ask which is more comfortable for you. Do you want us to like take the questions and tell you?
When the breakout happens, what is the volume that you have always seen? I prefer a 2x, 3x, 4x type volumes on the breakouts. Because then there is enough quantity also available on that day so that there is no problem in terms of being able to buy the quantity you want to. Do we see daily charts or weekly charts and monthly charts? So in small caps, see, the single day move is, say, 20% at times. So if you wait for the whole week or the month, the move is already done. So what we personally do is we look at daily charts. I also put a lot of charts on my website saying stocks on radar. So we have stocks on radar before the breakout. So on the day of the breakout, we've already created alerts in terms of price action, that we have to buy the stock on this breakout above this, and then we try to enter on the same day. So we are looking at end of day charts, but acting in the day. What is the typical PE for the mid cap indices where we can trade the small cap and mid caps? So there's no way to look at PE in terms of trading in small caps and mid cap indices. So let me give you an example. In 2016, the PE for the small cap index ended up being 80. The reason is there were a lot of small cap PSU banks in the index. And so a market cap of 5,000 crores for a small cap bank had a 3,000 crore loss. Now that will just churn the PE for the whole index itself. So what happens in a mid cap or a small cap index, the PE is irrelevant because one single stocks, one sector can change the PE of the whole index. Because a 5,000 crore market cap company, most company will make what? Not more than 1,000 crores, right? So a single company 3,000 crore loss takes out the profit or everything else. So do we have any screeners that we can follow for volumes? So there are a lot of volume filters available on various online websites where there are volume buzzers, volume shockers. All the brokers give you that data live also. So you can create your own, say in a lot of softwares, you can create your own also filters. You can just run a filter during the day, stocks more than 150% volumes or 50% higher volumes than yesterday on various websites. How do you scan the stocks? For me personally, we try to look at all the 1500 stocks on NSE on a regular basis. So whenever the trends are strong, we look at all the stocks on a daily basis. So it is by the eye, we don't use a lot of screeners. So for an example, this is a screener which is basically I run through all the stocks and we make such notes on a daily basis and share it with our team. So for us, it is basically going through all the charts by the eye. You can create screeners also. For us, this is our full-time job. So for us, what happens is we try to find more ideas than what we trade also. Why is this applicable only for small and mid caps? Should be also applicable to large caps. Now, the difference is in a large cap, there would be a breakout on a triangle may not give you a 50% move all the time. So what happens in a triangle breakout in a small cap, even though the target is 20%, the move could be 40%. So the large caps do not have huge swings all the time. So that is where you use a mix of technicals, a little bit of common sense, a little bit of relative strength. So a lot of relative strength studies work better on the large caps because, and you look at various different time frames on large caps. So for example, you want to be in IT stocks when IT is breaking out. In small caps and mid caps, what happens is two stocks of a sector will break out, the rest eight may not at times. Did not understand the concept of relative strength. How does one access it? So what is relative strength? In simple concept is, you are comparing a stock and an index or one stock and another index. So what do you do is you either do two bases in relative strength. You can go read on Google on various parts. I'll very simply put it. You'll do what? One is you look at what is doing better. in terms of price action. So for example, today the Nifty has crossed 12,400 levels. What is the relative strength? That 12,400 has not been crossed for the Nifty. How many stocks have crossed those sort of levels? How many stocks are doing better than the Nifty? So that you can do visually, or you can do it by doing a ratio chart. So for example, Bank Nifty by Nifty, ever since say February, March, April, it was always lagging off. So the Bank Nifty was never doing well. The Nifty went, Bank Nifty went across 25,000. That was the time it started showing relative strength. So that was the time the Bank Nifty started showing relative strength in the last few days. So that tells you, and the ratio chart, if you divide Bank Nifty by Nifty, will also tell you what is the relative strength. So there are various ways to look at relative strength, but the comparison is very simple. Was like you play cricket, you are scoring at a rate of strike rate of 50, the other batsman is scoring at a strike rate of 70. So you want to focus on the 70 guy all the time. Is there any technical indicator to entry and exit like MACD or RSI? Absolutely not in small caps. So don't use indicators in small caps and mid caps. Look for price action. Never look at overbought, oversold in small caps. Stocks can remain overbought and oversold forever in small caps. So the only thing you can do in terms of say small caps is look at price action and volumes. That's the best tool. Indicators, just do not look at indicators, my viewers, because you'll get focused. Can we use the cup and handle chart on the daily time frame? So this is where I have a little bit of a problem in terms of when people talk about daily time frame, weekly time frame, monthly time frame. The problem is, what is the time frame? One is candlestick is a time frame. Second is how much amount of time you look at the chart. That is your time frame. So if I look at the daily chart for 10 years, am I focusing on a very short time period or a very long time period? So the fact is, how longer you see the chart is your time frame analysis. But most of the time people constrict it by the fact of what is the candle size. Is it daily, weekly or monthly? So the longer the chart you take, the better it is in terms of time frame. So my view is, I look at daily charts, but I look at it at, so I look at the first 12 month chart, and then if I like something, I look at it a much longer term chart. So for me, it is time frame is one, the candle. Second is how long I look at it. So candlesticks work really well on longer term patterns. So it's not a 3 month cup. A cup and handle is not 3 months from start to end. We want more than 3 months cup and handle. Whether you look at the daily chart or the weekly chart, the swing highs will generally remain the same. The high of the week will not change if you take daily charts or monthly charts. So my view is, cup and handle works on longer periods of time. Your view over metal index and CPSE, please. So just last week tweeted about the metal index. We earlier did a YouTube video also when metals index was the JSW Steel was around 215, 230 and a lot of other stocks. So metal index is trying to break out of a very interesting cup and handle pattern. So it's very interesting. Public sector stocks, I actually find it to be one of the most say contrarian bets. Just 2 weeks back when we were right at the bottom and making a falling wedge breakout, I came out with a poll on Twitter saying, and one of the options was forget it. And a lot of people said, forget CPSE stock. Since then, the stocks are up 10 to 15%. Looks very interesting, but going into the, so we had a basket position, but going into the event, we cut it. The stocks are higher, but I find PSEs to be interesting. We will wait for more price action, but metals are surely interesting. Long-term duration breakout is mentioned as a prerequisite. The duration should be ideally over a year. Absolutely. So a longer term breakout on the index, yes, we look at 1 year. Then I'll go one by one. Do you change your percentage allocation to small cap?
So you can even pick random questions if you want.
Absolutely, I should have done that better in 2018 to 2020. So that's going to be my new rule. Change a major allocation to large cap or go into cash next time I see a divergence and stay for long period of time. Respected sir, some speech in Hindi. हिंदी में बहुत बात कर सकते हैं यार, बट हियर आई एंड अप टॉकिंग इन हिंदी इन अ मुंबई मुंबई स्टाइल, सो इट विल बी अ टोन उतना अच्छा नहीं लगेगा, बट समडे कोशिश करेंगे कि एक सेशन हिंदी में ही ले लें. Did understand the mistake made during the COVID times. So the mistake was not during the COVID times. The mistake was 2018 to 20. So COVID was just something which hit you out of nowhere. So the mistake part was for 2018 to 20, where we continued to remain largely small caps. How to scan small caps, or we have to check 695 charts. So you can look at the small cap BSE small cap index. You don't need to look at all the 695 charts of the BSE small cap. See, for us, we are full time into it. I look at all the 1500 stocks. It takes an hour or 2 hours on a daily basis to look at all 1500. And what I found is a lot of people do it. So for example, my teammate Harsh, when he joined me as an intern 4 years back, it took him 4 months to get back to my speed. And I think today he does at a similar speed or better speed than mine. I have seen a lot of people being able to do scanning stocks by the eye in a couple of hours. So it's not that difficult. It's just that whether you want to do it or is this your focus area or not. BSE alerts can be used for finding all notifications. There are many stocks which can do regarding stocks. You can do price alerts in Edelweiss, IFL, Sensible, so many stocks. Link for BSE Small Cap Index, you just go to search for BSE Small Cap Index on Google, you will get it. Which technical software, analysis software you've used? I've used MetaStock. There are many other softwares. So nowadays, data is available on various softwares. So you can choose your own. How long will the small cap and mid cap last historically? So we don't try to predict a lot more. We would like to take it as it goes. So till the time it makes higher tops and higher bottoms, we would go with it. How do you shortlist stocks? So one of the prime criteria is there are quite a few criteria in terms of shortlisting of stocks, like the shortlisting of patterns is low risk, high reward, volume confirmation, liquidity. So the last one is liquidity. You are using monthly time frames for RSI studies or weekly daily? So I look at daily charts all the time. I don't try to look at weekly or monthly charts. I just increase the time frame. So that is the way I look at it. So you can look at weekly and monthly charts, but monthly charts are an absolute waste if you're trading, your holding period is going to be less than a couple of months. So if your holding period is going to be years, then you look at monthly charts. It's going to be more than a year, 3 years, you look at quarterly charts. But if my small cap short-term trades are going to be period for a 1 to 3 month period, why should I be looking at monthly charts? So I look at mainly daily charts, but I can have a daily chart for a 12-year period also. So like the small cap daily chart, daily closing chart, you've taken it for a 12-year period. So if you make it a weekly chart, what will happen is the number of candles, the number of price points will reduce, but the line will remain the same. So that's an option which you need to take. This is what I find comfortable. What are your thoughts on dead cat bounces? So that dead cat bounces, now you can play a dead cat bounce in a liquid names. So for example, you can do it in a Coal India. Now you can't do it in a Reliance Communication, right? Because Coal India, even if it has to fall 50%, it will not happen in the next 5 sessions. It will happen over a period of time. But in a lot of terrible companies in the small caps, it can fall off 30-50% really, really fast. So try to trade dead cat bounces, even if you want to trade only on the larger caps. So in small caps and mid caps, the big learning over the last 3 years is stay with the trend. Do not try to fight the trend. It is really, really, say, it hurts you real bad. Thanks, Guruji, for your comments. What tools do you use for your day-to-day activities? So I keep it very, very simple. Like I said, I do blogging, tweeting, and chatting most of the times. So for us, it is end-of-day charts. For real-time, we look at, say, one is Falcon, or other is a Edelweiss or a Sher Khan. And the fact is, like in my team and in the circle, all of us tend to use different softwares which we are comfortable with. So Harsh likes to use a Sher Khan software just because he's become used to it from the time before he started working with me. That was the free tool he's used to. Another friend of mine, Ankit, he uses Falcon for everything else. I know somebody else who uses AMI broker. So in the fact, you have to understand what suits you best. It's just that we don't use a lot of automation. So most basic softwares are good enough. How do you take entry in triangle breakout in advance, as in when the breakout happens, when you miss on the large move? So that is why triangle breakouts, what we do is we create price alerts. So we create price alerts in a various say utilities which are available. And second, we keep tracking the markets. So we try to enter the same day most of the times, or the next day if the price move has not been 15% on the day of the breakout. Is it a good time to deploy money in small caps? Yeah, it's a good time to start hunting small caps. It's not the worst time possible. To identify symmetrical triangle or cup and handle, how many months data to watch, like 3 months or more? So generally, minimum data I look out for is 6 to 12 months. If you don't like something on the last 6 to 12 months chart, you may not like it on the last 5-year chart. So cup and handle breakout is more than 3 months. Generally, triangles are less than 6 to 12 months. So ideal triangle time frames are 3 to 6 months. So that's why a 6 to 12 month chart is good enough for looking at it. And once you like it, then you can unzoom the chart to the last 10 years. Doesn't matter. Now, if US election result is out, what's the chance of the market falling as was expected earlier? So I don't know. This was an expectation of markets falling as per the media. And the VIX was really high. And the markets tend to surprise in the possible direction. So in 2017, it was expected to be a fall if Mr. Trump becomes the president, and that was the best year. This time, we don't know. The markets have given their signals. The VIX has corrected. So we are let the prices confirm the trend change. So as of now, there is no sense of a trend change. So we go with the price right now. Don't try to. Can trade small caps for long-term investment. See, long-term investment more than 3 to 5 years implies that you need to know fundamentals, because businesses change really differently, right? Because what has happened is the cycles are different, disruption is different. So just because you have money and you have a holding period does not make you an investor. So what I say is, if you are looking at a long-term investment, which I believe is 3 to 5 years, then you need to know fundamentals of the company. And you can buy small caps, micro caps, if you've done your risk management, understanding of the businesses, ready with the risk. So absolutely, most of the money has been made in longer term investments in small caps and mid caps. When we call about blue chips, a lot of blue chips have given terrible returns. Because by the time we start calling them blue chips, so there's a 13-year negative return on L&T, right? It's a blue chip. It is still a blue chip. But you have to understand your risk management. Do Bollinger Bands help for entry exit for small caps? I don't look at Bollinger Bands as much. I find price action to be much easier. Cup and handle formation in making with huge volume JK tire. Yeah, so we like tires as a sector. I think I came out with a note on the a blog post on this sector maybe a month back when Fiat was at 950,000 rupees. So yeah, the sector has since then broken out. And that was the view after a couple of flip-flops, it should do well. The flip-flops have happened and a lot of tire stocks have made strong formations. JK Tire has seen a huge volume. So it's an interesting stock. Thanks a lot, Simar. I keep sharing stocks on Radar on the website. I am not supposed to share recommendations as such on a public forum. Don't want to have a lot of problems. Do you expect Nifty to go back to say 8,000? If so, when? I don't expect. So I'll be candid about what my view is. COVID-19 is one of the scenarios. How does it impact the chart patterns in longer tenure? Will this impact the way technicals are understood? So we've seen, so I believe all this falls. It's not the technical impact, it's the mental impact, which is much more tougher. So generation of investors who got hit in 1992 never came back for the next 10-15 years, because scars remain really, really long. Same way a generation of investors in 2007 have never come back for the next 10-15 years. So the businesses which survive will do well. Technicals will reflect the price actions, but the impact is not on the technicals, it is impact on us. So a COVID crisis suddenly shakes your belief in terms of longer term investing many a times. But so our friend says in the short term, a lot of things change. In medium term, a few things change. In the long term, generally nothing changes in terms of behavior. So what has happened is a COVID-like scenario reminds you of how life is difficult. Forget about just investing. So it will, the scars will remain for much longer. Should we exit if we get a rise by Diwali? Like I said, for me, a major exit should be if we get BSE small cap diverging with the Nifty. So if you see that, maybe, can you give names of good small caps where we can invest at present? Like I said, there's a compliance issue. And say, I'm an investment advisor also. So rest, you can always keep reading the website. I at least, even if I don't advise stocks, I keep putting up charts of interesting stocks so that you can decide whenever they break out. So I take my job as a, so I would not like to feed for free. Which software do you use to plot the charts? For me, the ones which I've used is MetaStock. Do you trade derivatives, and if yes, what strategy you use? So derivatives is a different ball game altogether because it's a function of leverage, etc. So there are totally different strategies which you use. It will take a very long discussion. And first thing you have to realize, for whom derivatives are not to be done. A lot of people can't do derivatives just because of the capital as well as the risk appetite. Is your internship program still on? No, it's not, because we've only decided a few people. How to increase chart reading speed? Kindly suggest. One simple rule, do not try to make a view on every stock. So try to focus on what patterns you like or what type of setups you like. Do not, so one thing, do not try to make a view on every stock. That sentence has a lot of meaning. I think if you think over it, Amit, you will get the answer. How to check delivery percentage volumes? You can check it on nseindia.com. You can check it on StockEdge and various other applications. Very interesting chart pattern, BSE small cap reaching its previous resistance. Exactly. So that's why it is interesting. If you look at a 1 to 3 year period, someday that will break out. Sorry, missed the software part. Any recommendations for beginners? Thanks. So there are way too many softwares available. So I use MetaStock because I've been used for a long time, but there is nowadays, even the free softwares by all the brokers are good. So as a starting, even investing.com, tradingview.com are good enough. I think there used to be a ChartNexus which used to be free, a Ganalyst which used to be free. But I think a lot of broker softwares are also good enough. So even on Zerodha, Sharekhan, IFL, Edelweiss have decent enough charts. Where to get insider trading details on daily basis? You can just Google insider trading BSE. I don't have the link right now, but I don't know if it's saved in my, yeah. So something like this is there in every stock, but there is a link called insider trading. It is there on my Chrome, but it will open up a view later. But it is available on daily basis on BSE. It gets every live, everything gets updated on it. Just search for insider trading new. You will get the link. Thanks Vikas for the view. Yeah, somebody has shared the BSE small cap chart. Sound is breaking a lot of times. So many a times it could happen because of connection issues at your end also. So now future of the market is greater. If you take longer the time frame, we are in interesting period. Why do I say we are in interesting period? What happened in 2020? So we came out with a very interesting note in on 24th March 2020, comparing fall in the market in terms of comparing it to 2008. So 56% of the stocks were down more than 70% on 23rd March 2020. And almost 60% of the stocks were down in 2008, in 2020. So that tells you a major big cyclical fall is over. So hopefully we may not get a similar breakdown in the near future. So that's why the future is much better than the recent past. when to enter trade, closing basis or trigger basis? Trigger basis. If you wait for closing basis, at times the risk reward goes way off. Have you plotted the Nifty PE with channels? This is it, seems have worked. So a couple of problems in plotting the Nifty PE. Right now the E has gone weird because of COVID crisis. So today some of the companies are showing great earnings because of cost benefits, which may not be there in the future. A lot of companies are showing losses because of the COVID problems. So the E is very weird. So I think normalizing it itself would be a problem. Apart from that, calculating the EPS of Nifty itself is a very tough task if you were to take consolidated, standalone, different, etc. So better is to take at the look at the Nifty chart rather than the Nifty PE chart. We've done a lot of, used to post about the Nifty PE chart before, but there are a lot of complications. And today, the Nifty PE has become a lot less relevant because Nifty has also become a lot less relevant for an investor because it's one of the most concentrated indices today. So like 2018 to 20, the big learning was Nifty can keep going up and everything else can keep going down. So that's why I say it's a very tough part to look at Nifty PE because 15% of the Nifty is Reliance, where you just can't understand PE. Then 35% is banking and financials, which is not ever valued on PE. How much emphasis do you give on fundamental research? Absolutely. So my first learning in fundamentals started in 2009. So when 2008 happened, I made some really good money in some stocks in 2007. Some of them were multi-baggers and some of them were extinct by 2009. So I realized, so an education company where I made good money, and then it is almost delisted today. And it actually did not have much of a business. I made money in one Nagar Industries and that stock went up 10x in a year, just because of the real estate value, but the company is still a dead stock after 12 years. So, and all the reports which we used to read online was terrible. So 2009 onwards, I've met a lot of investors over the year. I've done podcasts, interviews of investors, met one-on-one, sat with them, and then realized a lot of research, how much impact it goes into the research. So when you're looking at long-term, really long-term, so if you're looking at a 3 to 5 year call, on a single stock. See, if you're doing a diversified portfolio, it's okay. You have a 3-4% allocation to a single stock. Even if you're, say you bought a online company saying platform businesses are great, how much can you lose? You lose 50-80%, right? But if your allocation is 3-4%, it doesn't matter. You've just taken a broad theme, it works. But on a longer term basis, if you're taking a 3 to 5 year investment, it is fundamentals which really drives the business. So when you're looking at longer term, it is fundamental research. So like I said, most of the time technical guy says everything is in the price. Boss, aisa nahi hota yaar. Everything is in the price, then the price should go nowhere, right? Just like efficient market theory. So it's not everything is in the price. The fact is, if the business does well, the world does well, the prices go up and down. So absolutely overemphasis on fundamental research on longer the time frame. But for a 1 month view, maybe not looking at fundamental research. But one thing which I always want to do over the last few, say one big learning is avoid trading terrible companies. So wherever I see 5% delivery volumes, just don't trade them. Or trade companies, jiska pata hai ki those are frauds, don't trade them. Right. And personally, I'm the one who came out with the tagline called Chor Bane More. So I have a lot of working. So I know how to spot bad companies really well, but I may not know how to spot good companies well. One thing is absolute emphasis on avoiding the chores. Which sectors are looking good on charts for outperformance? So as of now, a lot of sectors which did really well, IT was the breakout before. Now metals have started showing strength. Watching out for FMCG, some of the FMCG names, but not the sector as well. Auto is on a multi-year cup and handle breakout, if it does well. So as of now, the new leadership has not started. So we are watching out. So in terms of the RS charts, etc., only metals has come up really strong on the ones. One sector which has no index per se, cements, which has broken out in the last few months. So we have a lot of cements which we like, but there we don't have a sectoral chart. is fundamental analysis not required for 1-2 years small cap mid cap investing? So fundamental analysis, it depends on whether you've done fundamental analysis. Just a fundamental analysis saying are API acha to ye stock bhi acha is not fundamental analysis. So my view is most people fool themselves in terms of fundamental analysis. Just because you could open an annual report or screen a dot in saying the ROC is 20%, so ye acha company is not fundamental analysis. So my point is how much work has happened, how much do you understand about the business, how much do you understand about the risk, and how much you understand what you are doing with the stock. So fundamental analysis is even required for a 3-month investing, right? So for example, if I'm buying a company with 5% delivery volumes with terrible promoter, right? I should not be buying a Vishal Fabrics or just because I got a WhatsApp, right? So there are companies which show great earnings, but receivables are almost equal to the sales. So even if I'm trading them, I can get hit real bad. So basic fundamental analysis is needed. So one, for a technical guy, you need to know in small caps what not to trade. Okay, where very low delivery volumes, just avoid, which we've talked about a lot. Second, you don't buy companies which have terrible history, right? So that is enough for you. But yes, for a 1-2 year investment in small caps, you need a little bit of fundamental analysis. A 1-month trade generally may not need 1-3 months. Make Money Organics, any view? So personally, I would not like to go with a company which is not shareholder friendly. Secondly, I have a problem in terms of the number of fire accidents the company happens in the company. So that is where I've had my problems with the company, and there is no shame in saying I've traded the stock before. But as of now, unless and until the last corporate announcement just put me off. So that's the view, even though it's a decent enough business. Technically, I might trade it, but fundamentally, it will be tough to invest in it. How do you see Supreme Petro chart? Does it top out? So it is very tough to spot the topping out in small caps. So the best thing is either sell on the way down, or if your targets are done, or you keep trimming your position. So I don't see Supreme Petro as of now, though I don't see a topping out, and topping out is very tough to spot in small caps unless there's been a very huge move. What do you think about packaging sector stocks like Uflex, Cosmofil? So this was a big mistake in terms of I was tracking the stocks fundamentally. Polyplex came out on our buyback radar at an absolute bottom. Cosmofil's promoters bought 0.5% of the equity at 200 rupees, 203 rupees. So that was a bad miss. Interesting sector and still very interesting. So it's just that it's like sour grapes for us. If you missed it now, you find it tougher to buy at current levels. But the trend is superb. None of the stocks have shown any trend change as of now. Any pointers on when to look out for correction, when correction is in around the corner? BSE small cap to Nifty divergence. How does one detect promoter operator manipulation of small cap stocks? 5 to 10% delivery volumes is one criteria which we look at. And then in the end, like there's a saying, operator bhagwan hota hai, jitni aapki shraddha utna dikhta hai. So when we go wrong, we blame the operator. When we go right, we don't blame the operator. So agar hamara stock chal jata hai, to operator nahi hota. So in the end, see, there is no operator or manipulator in all the stocks. What happens is at times if an institution is buying from 100 to 400 rupees, is it an operator? Is it what is it? What do you call it? Or is that someone taking a big bet? So what I don't like, what we can find it is purely operated stocks could be where there are 5-10% delivery volumes. Then if you look at, say, the float is 10% and the number of shares which get traded are so huge, means there is a lot of circular trading. So one, look at low delivery volumes, look at number of shares traded in compared to the float, then look at the shareholding pattern. So many a times in some terribly micro cap, small cap shareholding patterns, you'll see a 20 name list, promoter holding 25% and 20 other people holding 30%. So those are indications of operation. Your views on Vodafone Idea, why should I have a view on Vodafone Idea? That is the whole point. So I have no view on Vodafone Idea. So it's not necessary to have a view on all the stocks. And Vodafone, Idea, Yes Bank, etc. are great for media to talk about. I just don't have a view. I've always been scared of the charts. It's been a thanks a lot, Anand. Any last questions?
Sir, am I audible?
Training on reading charts for a complete beginner. Yes, the whole we have a whole video course which is for a complete beginner.
Sir, are you able to hear me?
Any view on media sector? Absolutely. I was tracking the media sector. I like it fundamentally, but the price action has not been great. So if they can break out September, October highs, I'll be very convinced on the whole thesis. All right, so I think I'll just answer a couple of these things. Rest, you can always send it to me and end it here. So last couple of answers. If we enter on ticker basis, what to do? The stock fizzles out on the same day. Hold. Like I explained in the charts, there will be a lot of fizzling out on the same day, etc. What is your maximum holding period for a trade? It could be months and years together. So at times if the prices have continued, so a trade has become an investment only in the money. So in 2016-17, a lot of trades became investment because then we understood fundamentals are also great and then we added more positions, etc. So you had a trading position become an investment position for 2 years also, 3 years also. What's your view on the Bank Nifty? Was so finally I have changed my view on the Bank Nifty. So in the whole period between March to September, we did not trade much of the bank stocks. Now we are open to trade any of the bank stocks because there is a relative strength. We'll just end the session in 5 minutes because it was mentioned till 5 p.m. So we'll stick to the time. Thanks, Nikhil. I would not like to give view on the stocks. Again, Yes Bank, I have no view. There are no books on volume analysis because world over nobody looks at volumes. IIFL Securities is an interesting business. What do you feel for IT? Do you see a... I love IT companies as of now. The trend is superb. Intellect, I have not looked at it, so no view. And I would not like to go to view on stocks. So how to identify any shift in sectoral rotation, any steps to follow? Oh, I have a, so even in the audio video course, which I've done, it takes a 1 hour to explain the sectoral rotation. So I think I won't be able to explain, but I've written a few articles on sectoral rotation on the website that may help. When do you know when to draw the line for cup and handle? So you look at flatter the better, and you look at swing height. Do not try to put trend lines anywhere. Swing height, very important height, very important height. All right, thanks. Construction sector is good for trade. I don't know what are the names in the construction sector, but yeah. What's the swing height? So what is the swing height? 12,400 for the Nifty, which was the all-time high, the swing high. 7,500 was a swing low. Very recently, if we made a bottom at, say, 10,800, that's a swing low. So that's a very critical, so the highest point or the lowest point in a particular time frame. So thanks a lot. I don't like to, do you see pharma index good for next 3-4 years? Very difficult to say for 3-4 years. Thanks a lot, everyone. All my contact details are anyways there. So you can always get in touch with me on any of this numbers. I think we'll shut the session here. Thanks a lot, everyone. Rest. I'm always active on various social media because that is how I have progressed and learned. So I've had Twitter meetups, I've had BlackBerry meetups, I've had back in the day Google group meetups. So I've learned from people via social media, and that's the reason I'm always open to doing webinars, etc. Because it helps me learn. Thanks a lot. I think I can take the
I'll take over. Sir, am I audible to you?
Presenter, and then end it if you have anything else to share.
Yes, I'll just do the closing remarks. Am I audible to you, sir? Okay, I don't think I'm audible to you. I'll just use the chat box. Guys, am I audible to everyone? Please say yes or no.
Yeah, you are audible. You are audible.
Okay, perfect. Okay, guys. Like today's session, I hope you guys enjoyed it. The session was on trading small and mid caps using technical analysis. We showed learned a lot of things from this session. It was by Nuresh. Nuresh sir has already given all his details, the various courses, and the presenter Abhimanyu is the the moderator. Abhimanyu was a moderator, and myself Ayush Agrawal, we are the moderator, both the moderators of the session. Now we are at Finvents. This is our website. You can go and check out our website. So we are launching in 6 days time. And this is basically a little bit about us. We will be doing such live events. We'll be having in-house case studies. We'll be having a dedicated social network just for investors and traders. And if you want to get an early access to our platform, you can click on the join button here and you will be able to get the early access to our platform. Early access is nothing but our annual plan at a discount of 500 rupees. That is what is early access is all about. So this is basically what is been event, basically what Finvents has been all about. And more than our early access and everything, we hope that if you have enjoyed the session, please do show your appreciation or your feedback and write emails to sir, post on his Twitter feed and let him know that you liked the session, you disliked the session, what was there that at least let us know, let sir know. So I think my Twitter also is somewhere. If you find it, you'll be able to find it. But more than me, sir was the one who was conducting the entire session. So you could post on his Twitter feed. I think that would be fantastic. So thank you guys for joining us. I think we can end the session now.